We're back from the commercial break, and I'm telling you, my next guest, somebody I met when he was a minor. Minor as in mining, you know, and not a minor, a minor. And today he is like one of the biggest bloggers in Ghana that we have. His presence on Facebook is very vibrating. He's on TV, and he's very, very fascinating. You want to know why? Stick around. Put your hands together. Show some love for my main man, Kwame, Gyan. Kwame, welcome to the show, man. Thank I've been you. Trying to get you here for ages.
Yes, I've been busy. You've been busy. We've been busy, but now we are okay.
Yeah. The first time we met, you were with Newmont.
Yes, I was. That was way back in, I think, 2010. I joined Newmont in 2008, January. And I think you came around 2010 for some session that we had with you. So I was there for 4 years as the senior communication officer for media relations, events, and tours. Then I moved to Airtel for another 4 years. I came in Airtel in 2012 as an internal communications manager. Then later moved to become the corporate relations manager and then the brand access manager. And I left there earlier this year in January.
Mm-hmm. You had a few exciting moments at Airtel, man. You had a few exciting moments, man.
I did. Excited. Okay, yeah. Okay, so it was, I think it was in February of 2014. It was when I put something up on Facebook. That was in the heat of the Ukrainian situation where the folks got tired of the government and then the parliament and then, just walked up there and said, look, get out of here if we can't do the work. So I said, I wish you had guts like the people of Ukraine. That's all I said. I wish you had guts like the people of Ukraine. Then there was a back and forth, as always, on my page on Facebook. It began on Friday evening. We had a back and forth with lots of the NDC boys coming through. I called him for a coup. I'm like, come on.
So when you said you wish we had guts?
Now, what I meant was actually what the guys in Occupy Ghana did on the 1st of July 2015, when normal folks, you know, in Ghana here, before protests get successful, parties give out t-shirts, put a bus there, give bottles of water, give you 5 cedis each, get on the bus, go to the venue, they give you placards, and then you protest. But this time around, I saw on Facebook that, look, let's meet up here to protest against it because it's getting too much. It was raining. I drove my car from home, went to the TV3 area, parked my car, and I found lots of other people like me who drove their cars, parked, and joined the protest. That's what I was calling for. You see, we're not angry enough in this country, KSM, if you ask me. There's so much going on that if we express our anger at what is going on, things will change. But for a long time, typical Ghanaians, famanyami, oh, it's okay. I mean, what has happened before? We'll be fine. Let's just move on like that. And so we go on and on and on and on. And everyone comes in. The same song happens. I remember the narrator man put up an image on Facebook. The Daily Graphic has over, I think, 2 or 3 years put together what seemed like the same headline back and forth. The president saying that Ghana's ready for takeoff. 2013 will be better. 2014 will be better. 2015 will be better. The same thing back and forth. Different language, different fonts a bit, but the same thing practically. So why are we marking time at the same place? Because we don't talk enough, we don't shout enough, we don't speak enough. 10 years back, platform was a bit limited. Either you had to send a text to a station that would choose to read or not to read. The presenter will look at your name, okay, yeah, let me read this one or not to read. You go to the websites of some stations, and then when you put things there, at their discretion, they pull it down or put it up. Then came social media, where we are our own website managers. You can shout all you want there, and then it gets noticed. If you've noticed, increasingly, things on social media have moved to become traditional media, mainstream news items. Mm-hmm. There are a few times that the president has actually put up announcements and some kind of comments on his Twitter handle or Facebook and carried on radio, on TV as well. Mm-hmm. So it's come to stay, and it's given us an avenue to vent our anger. And it's helping us a lot, because if you are there and then you can't speak out, then what's the point? So back to the issue about what I said in 2014. So I made this comment and people thought, and I know for, I mean, look, I've been told about this because I've been discussed several times on the WhatsApp platforms of these parties. Kwame is too loud, let's get to him and all of that. So now they said a good chance to get at him. So after Sunday, Monday morning, I wake up, I'm going to work, and my cousin calls me up. Have I seen the papers this morning? I was like, no, I haven't. I'm still driving to work. Four papers belonging to the NDC, when we know them. Kwame Gyan called for violent overthrow of Mahama administration. I actually laughed about it. Kwame Gyan called for coup in Ghana. I'm like, wow, really? Cool. Who am I to call for a coup in Ghana? Just because I made a point that they disagree with me on. Luckily for me, I mean, there was a back and forth, and there was a debate about it. And I knew my boss at work was going to call me, Philip Sowa, nice chap, understanding chap. So he calls me up before I got to work that, okay, I was coming to see him as soon as I got to the office, and I knew why. So I entered his office, said, you know who I've called you? I said, yeah. So what happened? I showed him what I'd said on Facebook. Oh, but that wasn't what you said. I said, yeah, Philip, I didn't see what he said. I said, okay. So pressure came on him for more kinds of things, and then eventually they thought that the best thing for them to do for me at work was to let me go home for a month. The first of all, I was given a warning letter.
I was like, what did the warning letter say? You're warned to do what?
You know, my comments on social media. Like, it didn't make sense, but I was like, okay, it's fine. It's okay.
What were they saying? It doesn't sync with the corporate brand.
That my action on social media has brought some kind of some long English, but basically, you know, for what I said. Like, what I said, it didn't even. Okay, so I said, okay, that's fine. The following day, I was called again by the HR. Okay, look, it seems that people are not happy with all of that is going on and that you have to go home for a month. I'm like, what for? Tell me what I've done to go home for a month. I posted on a weekend. I didn't use the company's anything to post anything on. My Facebook page doesn't mention me as a spokesperson of the company. Yes, it says Kwame Gyan, a blogger. I said, okay, let me go home. So I went home. At some point, Nanama Hajimana Santi, CTFM, was talking on radio and said, okay, she mentioned the Ukraine thing. So I sent her a text. Nanama, last time I mentioned Ukraine, I got a month suspension from work. And she called me up. She was on air, but she just left and called me. I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm like, yeah, I'm home because of the post I put up on Sunday. Like, no way. And then Richard Sky also calls me up. And Sky is a bit like me. He's a bit impatient, a bit aggressive, a bit passionate. And he calls me. What's another man talking about? I'm like, yeah, that's what happened. And I knew, I was like, Sky, just don't do anything, I'm fine. I'm okay, it's good, it's all right. Then he goes on Facebook, and then he puts up a post, and then talking about the fact that if people cannot speak their mind in this country, then what's going on here? Hashtag reinstate Kwame Gyan. So I didn't even see that. I was home, free vacation, so I was at the mall watching a movie, actually, with a friend of mine. You know, actually, I think I watched two movies that day. You know, at time, you know. and my wife and kid were then in London, so, you know, had more time. So, yes, there. And then someone called me. I said, go on Facebook. I was like, okay, I will. I didn't go. Second phone call, go on Facebook. I'm like, okay, I will. I didn't go. Then the third phone call. I'm like, what is going on here? So I go on Facebook, and as I scroll on my phone, all I could see was my name.
Your name?
Yeah. You know, people just condemn everything else. You did Kwame Gyan. The hashtag was going all over the place. Some guys had done an artwork that said, Airtel at that point had a product called Talk Chow. So someone brought up a counter offer, said Talk Chow zipped. So had someone who had a green face with a zip there. You did Kwame Gyan. I'm like, wow. So I got surprised about this. I mean, it was insane. And the following, that week, this was a Monday. That week, I think CTFM dedicated their morning show to me on a Tuesday or Wednesday. I can't remember KSM. Almost every station in Ghana called me for an interview.
Wow.
But I told Donald Vera, my boss at Airtel at that time, that look, I'm not going to grant any interviews because of this. I mean, if I grant interviews, it's going to fund this up. And
yeah.
No.
Yeah.
Then I got an interview, a call from a crisis support from the BBC. BBC has talked to me a month before when Facebook turned 10 years old about how, what are you Facebook for? So they had my voice. So I said, okay, I can't talk about this. I mean, I've given my word to my guys that I'm no interviews on this issue. So they said, but can we play back the voice from last month? I said, that's okay. So BBC did a story about how a certain gentleman's use of Facebook has got him suspended from work. And then they played back that voice of me. So the idea was to calm things down, but me going home,
yeah,
made it worse. So it was fun for me.
So were you officially sacked?
I was suspended.
You're suspended
without pay for a month.
Mm. And then you decided you wouldn't work there anymore?
No, I actually came back after work. You know, okay. The curious thing is when I was home, I got a few job offers. And I said, no, I'll go back. I have a point to prove, so I'll go back. I remember I spoke with some well-known lawyer, and he said to me, why didn't they sack you? I'm like, why? He said, Kwame, I'd have made you so much money, you can actually retire right now. and he was right, because they had gone through every aspect of employee relations and whatever it was, and I was not at fault, really. And they had gone through my Facebook page. I had not mentioned anywhere that I was this and I was that. So really, what is the point about it? But because some people think that the issue of governance should be left with, I mean, one of the silliest things I heard in the age of things was a comment by the Fifi Kweti. What is he in these days? Fifi Kweti is now the
transport
minister. He said at that time that if you want to do politics, but you can't be incorporated and then be doing politics. Such nonsense. So I get paid every month. Taxes are withdrawn from my pay. And I can't complain about how that tax is used. Why must the issue of politics only be discussed by politicians? It was on radio. I told myself for like 2 weeks or so, I wasn't going to make any comments about this, so I didn't. I was just quiet. The only comment I put up at that time was just before Independence Day, so I was just talking about Independence Day, and then, you know, that was about it. I just kept quiet about it. But really, if someone is there and thinks that because he's in politics, that he has a right to talk about it, who pays a politician, KSM? Mm. Really? I mean, I stopped looking at the tax components of my pay slip. From when I was in Newmont, I stopped looking at that thing because it just makes me sad. And then someone thinks that because I'm not a politician, I can't talk about governance. Really?
Edmund, I see you.
I mean, I'm based in the US, so you guys understand things a little better, but we're not getting there.
I smile because there's so much that I don't know. So in the interest of full disclosure, some things I don't know.
Mm.
I have never owned a Facebook page.
You haven't?
Intentionally. I have never had a personal. I have businesses I work with and I encourage them to have Facebook. Personally, you can't pay me to sign up on Facebook.
Really?
I don't.
Why?
I have nothing in my life that is so fascinating that I want to put in the world for somebody.
So, you have a great book.
Just did a great book.
You have. This is awesome.
I stick with my words. So nothing fascinating. I've always thought that way. Mm. And it served me very well up till now. So I think it'll take a little bit more to convince me to change. I choose not to speak too much on subjects that I'm not a subject matter expert on, as in some things you know very well. But free speech is one of those things you don't want. The moment there comes a chilling effect on the population, and for one reason or the other, people are not speaking up. Mm-hmm. That's a big problem.
Yeah.
That's a big, for good or for worse. You know, sometimes I sit in a taxi, and I hear a taxi driver talking about a president or somebody else, and my heart breaks for the man who is in power, you know, and, oh, God honest truth, I know I can't do that job because I see a guy standing on the side of the road, and the way he talks about that person who is doing his very best to help him, whether it's true or not, I know I can't do that. But in that same light, there's so much that goes on that a guy on the side of the street do not know, and that the only way he can voice his opinion is standing on the side of the street and screaming.
Before your post, I think one of the interesting posts I saw, you and the president, you took a picture someplace and...
It's interesting, you know. The president and my big sister, Margaret Amakoni, Dr. Amakoni of the University of Ghana, were actually classmates at some point in time. And then the first lady and myself actually grew up in Tamale. I was born in Tamale myself. My dad was transferred there long before I was born, and he lived there till he went on pension in 98. So Lord Ina Mahama and my sister actually grew up together. So we are still a family unit of some kind. I remember before he became president, they told him to come to our house at Legon every 26th or so of December. You know, it's you know, time of the year and all of that. So we actually have a relationship. When I lost my brother, my big brother, in January, and then Funa was in March, Lodin actually came there. And she was just serving everyone else like we all doing, because we're like family. That's what people don't know. But the question is, so what? Does that mean that she is hush because of I'm seeing something wrong? And again, it's the case. And the funny thing is, I've been labeled everything before at NPP, NDC, and all of that. But my point is this. And some have said that I lambast the NDC more. I'm like, yeah, they are in power. They manage my taxes. NPP does it. NPP wants to do that. But then again, if I hear things, but I mean, now they're campaigning. If I hear things from the NPP that doesn't make sense, I say it. I'm not wall is all kinds of things. And I've been told that some of the NPP guys have purposed that whenever I'm in trouble and being bashed by the NDC folks, they shouldn't come to my defense because they don't know when I'm going to switch. It's good for me, by the way. It means that someone is doing something which is...
Yeah.
I'm not neutral, I must say, because, look, I'm a voter, I vote. I have to vote for someone. I voted CPP before at some point when Green Street was standing for MP when I was in Legon. I voted for him. I actually voted for... NDC at some point again. Then I've also done NPP before. I based on what I hear.
Mm-hmm. Who are you voting for?
Good question. I'm here to decide, but I must say that I like what I hear from Indum.
Indum.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I like what I hear from him, frankly speaking, and I think that people make too much noise about the fact that it's a waste of votes and all of that. But the point is, if you don't vote for him, and others don't vote for him, then it becomes a waste. But if you all vote for the person that we want, it makes more sense to do that. So I like what Indum preaches. I like what he stands for. I like some of the ideas that I've heard from Nanado as well. I'm happy that this time around, you see, in the past, people just will give you this. How does it matter? Now we have been told how it's going to happen. For example, Baume has said that they're going to get $1 million or so for each constituency. I'm like, whoa, how? And he says that money is actually sitting down already. There's some account that has some money there already, and taking $1 billion from that amount to do ABCD makes sense. Like, okay, at least they know what they're talking about. Then John Mahama, you know, he's all right, I think. I'm saying this because I think if anyone has had the chance to make more impacts in this country, it's him. Okay, with experience that he's had as a has been an assemblyman, an MP, deputy minister, minister of state, vice president, acting as president for 6 months before being a president. He's had a lot more chance to learn, and I think to do better than he's done. Yes, indeed, things have not gone his way too much. Dumso, I don't blame him too much for Dumso. It's something that was waiting to happen, basically. But then how you handle it also counts. Then the economy has had its own somersaults with this dollar and CD playing around and all of that. Things could have been better.
Shots of love, man. Oh, man. Well, today has been a second day, man. Odadie day. I've been hanging out with the great Obeng Amakun Edmonds, putting out this book. And I think anybody in Ghana should get a copy of this book, man. Kony Mo is a fascinating musician. And when I was, by the way, checking up some little news on him, I found out that he is the most, when people hit Google for information, he has the highest when it comes to music in Africa. Show some love, man. And thank you, everyone, for putting up this book. And Kwame, I call you Firebrand. Are you?
I'm just normal, I think.
You're just normal. You just believe that you have the right to.
Yeah, and I think that the more we talk, the better things can be. I mean, for a long time, people think that we don't have a voice, a say, but trust me, people have things to say. And if you follow what people say, look, let's thank God for social media, really. Edmonds, I think so. Because you know what? Let me try and get you here. Because you know what? If people were to channel their anger elsewhere, it wouldn't be good. Now, someone gets so upset, just comes on Facebook, puts a rant on Facebook and then goes away. He's happy that he said it. Yeah? And look, the president engages on social media a lot. He actually lives there, basically. He lives there. He connects. I mean, they produce videos purposely for social media audiences. 2-minute video shot with drones and all of that. Because he knows what that can do. And mind you, there's that snowball effect for social media. So I'm on there. My mom is not on there, though she has a smartphone. So I see something there. I'll tell her about what I've seen. I'll show it to her. Look at what these guys have done here. She sees it, goes to the market, has a conversation with other women her age. So I've seen that thing once. It spread to 3, 4, 5 women who would then even spread it to their kids as well. So one person's presence on social media has an effect on what, 10, 20, 15 other people. So imagine if 2 million of us are on social media. We're impacting what? 10, 15, 20 million people as well.
Put your hands, man. Put your hands together. Well, I want to thank you all, you guys, for coming one more time. We'll sing the school anthem on closing. You ready?
I was hoping we wouldn't sing.
You never learned it.
So we all did. It was compulsory, you know. For once, compulsory.
Yeah. So for you, I'll give you a big up from here and say thank you so much.
Thank you.
And as we go, we'll sing our school anthem. 2, 3, 4. Happy are we.
No, it's happy are we.
Happy are we.
So there you go.
Happy are
we. Happy are we.
Oh, really?
Happy are we.
Studios are we. Students of Presbyterian Secondary School. Onward we march with trudge along to happy victory. To victory, to victory. Our motto is a solid bulwark propping us along. In the light, we shall see light. Illuminato, videbimus lumen. For Christian training, we get a sure, solid foundation to take our places in the future of our country and church. For Christian training, we get a sure, solid foundation to take our places in the future of our country.
So come along and join us.
So there you go. Come along and join us. Happy Studios are we.
So my... You like to win in 1970.
You know.
Very good.
Okay. Oh, hey, you're playing. That's it for Stick Around. There's more to come. We'll be right back.
If you're having as much fun as I am, stay tuned. If you're not, you need deliverance. We'll be right back.
KSM Show.